have come to Bible, and I forgot to tell you all, I'm reading from the New King James Version. I forgot to tell you all that. So we're going to go back. Pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. If someone has done something to you, it is up to you to pursue peace with that person. And the Bible is our outline. And I don't know exactly where it is, but you mentioned the gospel of health. Where the Bible tells us if we have an ought with our brother, first we go to our brother. And then if our brother won't hear us, then we go and get us a witness. And we go and we try again. And then if our brother doesn't hear us, then we can move on. But let me tell you, a lot of us don't do that. We just instantly move on. I have done it. I am the queen of I'm gone.
There you go.
But in my past, I would be the queen of, if somebody did something to me, I would disappear. And that's that. I wouldn't fix it. I wouldn't. Oh, okay, well, they said this, and I'm just going to stay away just so that I could cover myself. But I didn't realize that that's not how you guard your heart. You guard your heart by going back and fixing it.
Fix it.
That's what you have to do. Fix it. So in order to do this, you have to pursue peace with all people and holiness. You fix it in holiness. Because you know some of us like to fix it back in some other ways. We will not slash tires in Jesus' name.
Okay.
And we will not paint worship and gas tanks. No. We're going to fix it in holiness. Yes, Lord. I've never done that, y'all. I have time. I've never had that spirit now. So when you look at carefully at anyone falling short, let's be falling short of the God. And a root of bitterness springing up caused trouble, and by this many have been defiled. So many people have been defiled and don't know about bitterness. Amen. Even in leadership.
Yes.
Even in leadership. My husband and I, we serve in leadership, and things happen. And in leadership, if we ourselves are not aware of it, the things that people will say and the things that people will do, they will try to creep in, and then you become defiled and still trying to lead and still trying to serve. And ministry is good. It's a good workout. Great workout. So working with people is a great workout.
Amen.
There are things that have been done and have been said. And so it's up to us to go back and fix it so that their bitterness, their root doesn't spring up. And so once we come out of bitterness, we have unforgiveness.
Yes.
So let me tell you about bitterness. Bitterness, once it has turned into real unforgiveness, it is hard. I mean hard. And you would think, because forgiveness is that thing that he talks to us about. If we can't forgive, he won't forgive us. So you would think we would be quick to forgive, but we have to remember, bitterness tells us that we are okay. We think we're fine. We have moved on. No, we haven't. Those roots have formed into that nice, solid oak tree of unforgiveness. And unforgiveness is seen. It is seen. You can tell when a person has a spirit of unforgiveness that they might not be able to see it, but it is seen. So we're going to go through the unforgiveness for just a second. What is unforgiveness? So in order to know what unforgiveness is, we have to go to the root word, which is forgive. Right?
Right.
Okay. So in order for us to know what unforgiveness is, we have to go over to the root word, which is forgive. So what does it mean to forgive? Huh? To stop feeling angry? To stop being resentful towards someone or something?
Yeah.
You don't believe how many people have been building.
Right.
To stop being resentful towards someone for an offense or something for an offense, a flaw or a mistake. To forgive means to cancel someone's debt. How many of you know that Jesus died on the cross to cancel all of our debts, and yet we cannot forgive our brother or our sister for stealing our car and tearing it up and blowing up our motor? I'm just saying, it happened to me twice. He blew it. blew up two of my motors. I'm talking about myself. So I'm saying, he died on the cross for every sin that we commit, that we would commit. Yes. And yet we can't forgive someone for something so simple as taking our credit card and maxing it out. And I wanted it to be that because you know you think like, wait a minute, that's deep. Actually, it's not. It's no deeper than somebody maliciously doing something to you or somebody doing something unknown to you. It's all the same because it's really all the same. It produces bitterness that turns into unforgiveness. So it's simple. The person that molested you, okay, think about it. It was a big, that is a big deal. But to somebody that was their last dime and someone stole their credit card and they had a bill to pay, that was a big deal. Someone killed a family member, murdered someone close to you. That's a big deal. But someone going to have an abortion without telling the father, that's a big deal as well. So it's all the same. It's to you. How does it affect you? How does it make you feel? That's what it's about. So when we go back to forgiveness, we're going to go through something. Because a lot of people forgot about this. I don't know why, but I love it. The Lord's Prayer.
Yes.
Amen.
Everybody wants to be deep. Everybody wants to intercede and go all the way to third heaven. Let's start right here. And I'm going to read the whole thing, but then we're going to focus on verse 12. But we are in Matthew 6. We're in Matthew 6, verse 9. Verse 10. We'll start at 9, going into 10. 9a, 9b. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. I love the Lord's Prayer, but everybody skips verse 14. Right after he gave them this to pray, they always forget verse 14. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses. So I ask you again, when we all get there, will you be there? Because the question is, have you truly forgiven? Have you truly forgiven? If you see that person and something twists in your heart, I tell people all the time, you do speak those things that be not as though they were. You speak them. You speak them. And you say, I forgive.
Yes.
But sometimes it does take going back to the person and saying, you know what, you need to sit down and we're going to have to talk this thing out because I'm not there yet. I'm trying to get there, and we're just going to sit down and we're going to work on it. And if it's someone that you can't work on it with, that's you and God, because some people have died and gone on, and you can't talk to them, and you can't tell them that you did this to me. And some people won't hear you. They will reject knowing what they did to you, but that's not on you. That's on them. It is up to us to forgive, because why? When we all get together, what a time, and we all want to be there. We all want to be there. So bitterness, unforgiveness, we have to remember that we serve a Lord. We serve a Savior who has done something for us that no man, no woman, no husband, no wife, your children, your teachers, your professors, your kids, your coaches, your girlfriends, boyfriends, he did something for us that no one did. He died for us, and he shed his blood for us. So It's a heart check. It's a heart factor. Because you're not going to get in with it. There are going to be people there that you won't even think will be there. And that there are not going to be people there that you don't know, where so-and-so? Oh,
yeah.
I didn't know. Because bitterness, remember, is the thing that will go in and it'll hide. And it'll creep right up under your heart, right in the back. And it's injecting venom the whole
so then you have the faith to forgive even when you're right. Do you have the faith to forgive someone that has wronged you even when you're right? See, it's okay to forgive the person. It's easy to forgive someone who wronged you. But when they wronged you, they don't realize it. You gotta show them what they've done wrong. And then now you got unforgiveness because they mess over you and didn't acknowledge you. So do you have the faith in you to forgive a person who's done you wrong when you're right? See, that's tough. Because then you really get puffed up because you're right. And you all you can make them see how wrong they are. So then you puffed up, you're right, and you're angry. And you get angry at it because you see it. Because now you're talking about them, you put your mouth on them, you're being ugly, you're being cruel. So now you move on again and then anger, now you're sinning, you're probably cussing too. So when we get to a place that unforgiveness begins to creep in and we have business venturing in, we have to keep ourselves clean. Keep ourselves pure. Ask the Holy Spirit. See, we have to have the Holy Spirit in our life. See, Holy Spirit brings about conviction and correction, comfort and guidance. And Holy Spirit correction when you sit within the beginning and creep up unaware. Holy Spirit puts in and convicts you. Makes you check yourself. When people walk in the room, you look at the roll of your eyes. Or you know it was next week. You see them coming in here. Now she know. Or he know. I've done it. Be funny with my wife. They feel like I said that to me because I ain't got that full of that. But we've all been there at one point in our life or another. And see, we're talking about unforgiving ability, but that can be whatever it is in your life. It may not be bitterness. It may be lust. It may be fornication. It may be a lying tongue. But you, whatever it is, you must, as she said earlier, pursue peace. Because we're all in pursuit of heaven. And when you're pursuing something, that means you're running it down. You're chasing after it. You're not going to stop until you get it. If a man sees a fine woman and he wants, he's going to pursue her all day. All the time she ignores his phone call, he's going to keep calling. Until he wears her down and she calls and says, what do you want? That's pursuit. When you don't give up, you are relentless. There's nothing going to stop you until you get what you're after. And see, we chase the wrong stuff. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and everything else. We added unto you. See, you chase everything else. And not chase God. But if you chase God, everything else comes with him.
Amen.
See, our priorities are all fixed it up. But you gotta put your priorities in order. See, if you want peace, you gotta seek after the peacemaker. God give you a peace that surpasses all understanding. You gotta put things in order and proper perspective. See, when you put this out of perspective, you can't expect to get the promise of God. The promises are yea and amen. And if you want to receive the promise of God, you must obey the word of God and be in the will of God. See, we overlook the will for what I want. The Bible declares in Psalm 47 that he will give you the desires of your heart to like it up in him. See, there are things that God, the Bible promises us that that will come to us if we do what He commands us to do. See, we desire the promises of God, but want to skip the process that He puts us through to receive the promise. See, we're talking about holding things in our life that will keep us from getting to the great evening in heaven and being at the great gathering place. See, we all want to get to the great gathering place, but if you can't get together down here, how are you going to get together in heaven?
Yeah.
See, we can't get it together down here. Somebody not going to make it up there.
Okay.
I'm just telling the truth.
Yeah.
If you can't get together, how can you love God when you've never seen Him? Dislike, don't like, hold the unforgiveness and bitter against your sister and your brothers you see every day, and you have the opportunity to make it right. See, God is so wild and He's so powerful in what He does and how He does things. He will create opportunities for you to forgive them. He will create opportunities to see what you're going to do under pressure. Let me tell you, share a testimony with you real quick. There was a couple we used to remember from Goodwill, and there was a couple we had invited into our home, and we had great lunch with them. We were getting along really well. You know, we had kids who were getting along really well, was doing things together, and then we had They lied on us, they started spreading ugly lies, ugly untruths about us, and they ran to the pastor and told the pastor these lies, and now the pastor looking a little sideways, and this kind of stuff, and the other. Marcus, hey, we cut them loose.
Oh.
You know, we done washed our mouth, we done baked, we done hung out with the fellowship, but we just ain't got time for that. And then Apostle Rush Cameron said, he wanted to make me an elder. He wanted to ordain me as the elder of the church. And he's all that is the same guy as the youngest way. And we sit in the meeting, I'm like, I don't want to wait. I mean, it's unresolved. We ain't talked about it. But, I mean, we hadn't talked about it. We didn't find a resolution, so we just stopped talking. But we in that meeting, I'm like, God, I can't be effective in ministry serving someone who I'm holding up with.
That's right.
So we're sitting in the meeting and he's talking to us about what our duties are to the elder and what we're going to want to do to have in the ministry to send the elder. And after the meeting, we had no option. And we had to apologize and forgive. Because the Holy Spirit has convicted me enough to the point where I know I can't be effective in my ministry if I can't work with the person I'm called to serve.
Amen.
So we had to go over there. She was there, his wife was there, we went over and we said, let me talk to y'all. Explained a while ago, mistake, whatever, we said we're not going to go into details, but something happened. And we need to serve because we both can be elders in the ministry, we can be leaders in this ministry, we got to work together. And we got to do one. We talked about it, you see, we prayed about it. Right after the meeting. Nobody prompted us with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit prompted us. No man prompted us. We talked about it and prayed. Right there in the circle. We prayed. Asked about the temple. Move out and up against in our heart with one another. And it was good. We began to work in ministry. We began to serve it. And things were going good. We come from Birmingham. We went to Birmingham all weekend. And we come from Birmingham. And the car went out. On 65. We on 65, right outside of Birmingham. I don't think we have any in Montgomery yet. We was in Alabama somewhere. Middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
Truck termination went out. It's me, my three boys, my wife. We had just took one of my sons to Chicago, went to the airport. We on the side of the road. I called mom and dad to tell them we broke down, called the rest or whatever. We see what we're going to do, get the truck to the next exit, and there's time or something. And yes, we came down 65 and saw us. That same court, but we had to go back and forgive him. What are the odds of that?
Yeah.
So I'm going to go to my phone ring, and it's the guy, I said, hello. He said, hey, are y'all on 65? Broke down. I said, yeah, we are. He said, let me just pay. We're going to turn around and come back and get y'all. They turned around, came back, put all of us in their truck. And we came back to Mobile and took us to our house. Now the question I asked myself, Had we not forgiven each other and
that's
talked
right.
about
that's
it,
right.
yeah. would they have stopped or kept on going?
Yeah.
Had we not stopped and talked and hashed it out and reached together as brothers in the ministry as men of God and talked about it and come together and reason about it, would they have stopped or kept on going like they can see us? See, you don't gotta think about it. The very people you trying not to enjoy, you trying to hold unforgiveness on the very people God put in your life to be a blessing to you. But you gonna miss your blessing over some stuff, over some junk, over some mess. You gonna miss the blessing that God has locked inside this person. See, we're married. I'm not gonna tell you every day we get along. People think we do because we got great personalities.
That's right.
And we do. She's a great person. I'm a great person. But all day, we're not great together at all. I mean, it says, if you marry, you know what I'm talking about.
That's right. Yeah.
But I cannot receive the Bible says, he that found the wife find a good thing and obtain favor from the Lord. So I don't care how upset or aggravated I get. Or whatever she did with me or I did with her, I can't hold unforgiveness over her head because there's something locked inside of her that God has given me access to that I can't get until I get in agreement with her.
That's right.
The same thing works the other way around. There are things God has locked up in me that she can't properly receive until she walks in agreement with me. How can two walk together except they agree? See, I'm talking about a marriage, but we got friends and family and fellowships that we're called to walk together with hand in hand. But you can't walk because you can't agree together.
Yeah.
So then what happens then? How do we get over this? How do we overcome it? How do we overcome it? It's so simple. You just tell God about it.
Yeah.
Just talk to God about it. Tell God what you're unable to do. Because there are times when I'm praying and I want something. But then I want God to give me his will for my life. Am I gonna really hear what God says if I really want it bad enough? I don't have to look all for it. You know, I'm gonna hear what I want to hear. But I get that, but God just God, I need God take away my will and give me your will for my life. And see, there are things in our life, there are and Paul says there are thorns in our flesh. That we can't take away, but God's grace in our life helps us to persevere through them. And we need to let God know, God, I'm unable to handle this on my own. I need you. God, I need you. I need you in your Holy Spirit to convict me, to bring me direction, to give me a way out. 1 Corinthians 10:13 says there is no temptation coming to man. But the every temptation give you a way out that you may be able to stand, may be able to sing. So we have to get to a place where we trust the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit first must be present in your life. And when the Holy Spirit is present in your life, trust him enough to direct you, to guide you, to lead you, to order your steps. Let's look at, we're going to look at Matthew. Matthew said, same chapter. Down on to verse, we'll go on to verse 7. Ask, and it shall be given unto you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receive it. And he that seeketh, find it. And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. Or what man is there of you whom, if his son asks bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks a fish, will give him a serpent? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father, which is in heaven, give good things to them that ask him? See, we talked earlier about seeking. See, when you're really seeking something, That means you are finding it because, I mean, you can't go any further until you find it.
Yeah.
You have lost your key. Mm-hmm. You're seeking out the key.
Right.
You can't go anywhere until you get your hands on the key. And that comes to be about certain things in our life. That we're seeking God so fast and so hard and so passionately that until I get there, I'm not satisfied.
Yeah.
There's always something missing. But the problem comes here. The problem lies here. Is that we don't ask God to do things and all. Because there are some, which is true, but there are some things that we just like having in our life. It's certain things that just feel so good to our flesh. That we're not even 100% sure that we don't want it anymore.
No.
So we wave it back and forth. I don't want to say, Lord, take it for it, Lord, take it for it, Lord, remove it, Lord. Give me the grace to come through, Lord. Give me the grace to stand myself, Lord. I just thank your Holy Spirit directly in order and keep my mind. I'm casting down my vain thoughts and imagination. And I'm doing all this and I'm walking in the Spirit because I want to do the right thing today. But then tomorrow when I smell the cologne or I smell the perfume or I see something that entices my flesh, just, I start praying. I'm just, and it's not that I really want to do wrong or that I really desire to do wrong, but it's just that. Ain't nobody going to know. That's the only thing that's going to keep you when there's one that's wrong with you.
Right.
Wow. There's one that's wrong with you or the person you've been seeing. We have to be accountable to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is there to order ourselves, to comfort us, and to guide us.
Right.
He's there for just that purpose and for just that reason. But we have to give him liberty in our life.
Mm-hmm.
We have to give him freedom in our life to be just that in our life.
Yeah.
So we get to the big meeting, and we want to get there, we have to confess to God and seek him out and ask him to remove it and knock on the door until you beat it down to get what you want behind it.
Amen.
You got to knock on the door to get what you want behind it. You got to get, sometimes you have to get downright ruthless in the spirit and go into warfare mode because what you have, God, the world is giving. And the world should not even take it away. And you can't give up so easily what God has given you. God has put a great deposit into each and every one of you. And he desires to receive a great return with interest on his deposit in your life. And that means you have to protect it at every cost. That means you can't allow things to creep in on a web. And when they're done, you have to arrest it in that very moment. When you see a burglar coming in your house, you don't wait to get in there and put him out. When you see him coming, you begin attacking demons. When you see him coming, you begin to alert and attack demons. Because if you wait to get inside, it's too late. It's too late.
Yes,
sir. So we have to begin to arrest it and stop it at the door. Don't even allow it to come nigh your dwelling. Because the ultimate goal is to get there. The ultimate goal is to make it easy. The ultimate goal is to hear him say, servant, well done. That's the ultimate goal. We want to celebrate, we want to rejoice, and see the pearl gates and the streets paved with gold. We want to get there. We can taste it.
Yeah.
We can see it. We want to experience it. But we have to get it right down here.
Yeah.
See, this is your dry wound right here.
Oh, yeah.
See, this is your test wound. When you go to school, they give you a pretest. This is the pretest.
Yes.
So you have to get it right down here. And guess what? If you pass one test, you don't fail the whole class. It's okay to miss the mark every now and then. When you think you fail one, it's okay. You're not going to fail the whole. You're not going to fail when it's one or two. Because you said you were sleeping out there, you missed it.
Yeah.
It's important audience. But when the time comes again for that same test, you should have passed. You should have failed the same test twice.
Yeah.
You might not get 100 the second time, but you sure should have failed it. And then after his righteousness, to seek after what he has for you. You have to be relentless in your effort and the pursuit. That's the word pursuit. Because when you get there, you want to see the same people you see there right now. The same folks on your road, you want to see it when you get there. And see, that's what you want to keep yourself accountable. If you see a suit on your brother falling, help him up. Don't take him with it now. If you see him slip, you want to grab him before they fall. You want to keep people around you who are not afraid to correct you when you're wrong.
That's right.
So you got too many amen folks in your room. You got some people that are saying you are wrong, you are dead wrong, you need to get it right. You need people in your life that will keep you accountable to the man and the woman of God that God has created you. People that see your future and not your past. People that see your future and not your past. See, people that only see your past will always keep you where you were. Because if you move from where you were, then you end up surpassing them. If you leave them, then that means they're going to be gone too. So they got to have to keep you where they are. So this morning, you get nothing else this morning. If you get nothing else, let nothing separate you from the love of God.
Amen.
Let nothing separate you from worshiping the living God. See, when we all get to heaven, what a time, what a time, what a time. When we all get to heaven, what a time, what a time, what a time. It's going to be a great celebration.
Oh, yeah.
To see Jesus. To see all the beautiful works of his hand in hand. But wouldn't that be an awful experience to get there and not see the ones you worship with every Sunday? Or get there and they not see you. See, it's nothing worse than you hear about a party that you weren't invited to see.
Okay.
And they tell you how much of a good time they were, how much fun they had, and you wasn't even invited to the party. But all your friends went. Don't miss the party. When we all get there, what a time, what a time, what a time.